I thought about who's the best to be able to help you experience a breakthrough for your network marketing career. One name came to mind. He's here tonight. He's here to bring you some value. And we've got a special video as a way of introduction. Check out the video.
I've always been fascinated by that force that shapes human beings. Who am I and what am I here to give?
You are a catalyst for getting other people to change the way they think about themselves.
As painful as this is, human beings can change one of two ways. They can change because there's an opportunity, they just decide to go make it happen, or they do it because they're at a threshold.
I was looking at the list of people that you have helped. Bill Clinton, Princess Diana, Mikhail Gorbachev, Mother Teresa, Nelson Mandela, Quincy Jones.
Tony Robbins is a master of human elevation, a true influencer of thought leaders worldwide. Throughout his 30-year career, Tony has advised global leaders, celebrities, and some of the world's top athletes. Tony focuses on how to elevate one's wealth, business, performance, and personal growth.
I came away with, it's not about motivation as much as it is allowing people to tap into what's already there, like a catalyst.
Every person in this room who's achieved anything, we've had that hunger. The question is, where's your hunger now?
If you want to change your state and you want to change your results, this is where you do it.
Coming actually here to have that many people focused on one intent, super powerful, it's rocket fuel.
We were brought here in life to learn a lesson.
I get the phone call when the athlete's melting down on, in the middle of a sporting event. You've got to do something right now to turn them around.
This whole idea that Tony had of modeling. Look at people who do things that inspire you and then apply it to your own life.
I was introduced to Tony Robbins when I was 15 years old. I remember feeling after that just unstoppable.
I think Tony Robbins allows those people who want to continue to climb mountains to climb them.
Our job as leaders is see it better than it is. That is not positive thinking, it's called vision.
Tony's events have attracted more than 50 million people from around the world.
Ni hao ma, buongiorno, Ohio desaimo.
Tony has reached over 4 million people from 100 countries with his seminars, books, audio, and video recordings. Tony is a recognized authority on leadership, negotiations, organizational turnaround, and business elevation. The companies Tony Robbins has started and partnered with
gross over $5 billion in annual revenue.
Tony teaches individuals and business owners to lead effectively, efficiently, and profitably, focusing on how to thrive in any economic time with strategies and blueprints from the world's most successful entrepreneurs, organizations, and global leaders.
But it's all come out of this hunger to constantly make things better, and it'll change you as an investor. It'll make you wealthy.
Tony strives to change lives around the world for the better.
People forget what a little bit of caring can do for, to inspire or to move somebody, and that's what I think changes people's lives.
It's time to elevate your life, elevate your world.
All change happens with a choice.
Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready? Show your love for the number one success coach in the world, the top influencer in business around the world, the one, the only, Tony Robbins! It's crazy what happens today. People stand up today and they pull out their camera and they shoot shit that they don't see. How are you? It's nice to be back. I only do usually 6, maybe 12 independent talks outside of my own organization because my schedule's so full in a year. And I kind of pick who I want to do it with. Rarely do something more than once.
but Eric and Rain are kind of family for us, and I feel a kinship with all of you. I'm excited to be here, seeing so many of you that have traveled from all over the world. Who came from outside the United States to be here? Wow. How many Americans in the audience out there? I'm just curious. Awesome. Well, I'm excited to serve you. It's my biggest challenge and opportunity is at the same time. The challenge is that I've got less than 3 hours, which may sound like a lot to you, but the shortest thing I do is 50 hours. And I don't do it because I like talking. I do it because I believe in conditioning. If you're going to train your muscles, you can do it mentally, but if you do it physically over and over again, you develop a habit. And so we got 3 hours to see if we can't establish some habits. And so the good news is I found a format that I think will be really, really helpful for all of you. And also because we have so much in common. I mean, all of you in this room, I have such respect for you. I've never met you personally. I've met about 100 people beforehand. But my respect is because you picked a very different path than the vast majority of human beings do. Right? You didn't take the last path of least resistance. You took the one with strongest resistance. Right? You picked yourself a profession where your raise becomes effective when you do. You picked a profession where you can get in for a couple hundred dollars, but you can make millions of dollars a year. You can be in business for yourself, but not by yourself, as we all know. But all that sounds really wonderful. And then there's the reality of business. There's the reality of dealing with people. There's the realities of rejection. There's the reality of all things you face. If you can master those realities, then the gifts are beyond imagination. And I'm just a kid from Southern California. I grew up downtown LA. I didn't have any special gifts except one thing. I love people. And I was obsessed with any way I could learn to help people. I first wanted to help myself, quite frankly, but then I wanted to help anybody I could. And because of that motive, and by the way, jot down if you would, motive does matter. You know, if you're looking at your business and how you're going to grow your business and you're in it for yourself, there's nothing wrong with that. Because life supports whatever supports more of life. If you doing better makes life better, you're going to get insights. But if you're trying to do something to support your family, not just yourself, there's a different level of motive. There's a different level of energy. I really believe that life supports that which supports more of life. So if it's just you, you get insights because you're part of life. If it's you and your family, even greater insights. If you're trying to support your community, you get a whole different level of insight. If you're trying to support humanity and it isn't bullshit, it's really what your soul is about, you'll get insights that most people never dream of. That's really been my ticket. And along the way, one of the things I want to talk to you about tonight, since you're all in business, is really what does it take to really grow your business? Because I've had the privilege of starting with nothing, and now I have 31 companies. We're in 7 different areas, radically different areas, from virtual reality, where we're the number one company, we're the partners of the NBA. You'll start seeing not only Monday Night Football, but Tuesday Night NBA, virtual reality. Or partners exclusively with Live Nation, so you can go to concerts in that area, to the top resort in Fiji. The diversity I have is amazing. More than 1,200 employees, we do more than $5 billion in sales, and it started with zero and with nothing. So I'm excited to share with you some insights that can help you to really go from wherever you are right now to wherever you truly want to be. But I'd love to give you a little background first. My background's really simple. As I said, just driven to help people, hungry to understand answers. Part of those were just for myself. I grew up in a really tough environment, and I couldn't understand why this was my fifth father. I said to my mom, I'm confused. I was not the popular kid in school, even though I love people, and I wanted to connect with people, but the most popular kid in school was the most mean son of a bitch. Who knew somebody like this? It was really popular and mean as shit. I couldn't understand it. How is this guy popular when he's so horrific? But what it made me do is it made me hungry to understand human beings. And so early on, I didn't have any mentors. I didn't have anybody who could coach me. There was no one in my family that had been successful in business terms or, quite frankly, even happiness terms. And so I turned to books because my original teacher, Jim Rohn, used to say leaders are readers. And he used to talk about, you know, read every single day. You miss a meal, but don't miss reading, and I took it to heart. And I said I was going to read a book a day, but I didn't quite do that. But I read 700 books over 7 years, all in the area of human development, psychology, physiology, anything that could make life better. I wanted the answer, and I figured out how to apply it, make improvements in myself, so I knew it worked. And once I knew it worked, I had so much passion that I could get through to anybody else, and I could help them as well. But the first early stages were just looking for the answers. And as I try to find answers to why my life was not the way I wanted it, I looked around at first and generalized. Maybe the way some of the people you recruit generalize. I'm sure you don't this way. But I would generalize and go, well, you know, I grew up in this really tough community and we live on the other side of the tracks and, you know, come on, these people have all these resources we don't have, right? All these people, they grew up, they've got plenty of money, they have a great education, their family stayed together, there's all this great love. And so all of my assumptions were these people were lucky, they had some resource I didn't have. But when you're halfway intelligent, and if you read biographies, you begin to realize that the smartest people in the world, the most successful people in the world, usually have had some of the most horrific backgrounds you can imagine. And pretty soon I began to realize that biography is not destiny. That where you've been has nothing to do with where you're going unless you spend your time looking in the rearview mirror. You know, if you're trying to move forward, look in the rearview mirror, you're going to crash. And so very quickly, early in my career, I started coming up with these insights and answers. And I stopped generalizing after a few times. I remember, for example, reading the story of a person I'm sure you know, a young girl who's born to a 13-year-old mother. And what do you think the future is? If I just told you this, baby has a baby, 13-year-old has a child, there's no father there, what's the future? Not looking too good. What if I told you that a young girl was African-American at a time when the President of the United States was not, and when people judge people by the color of their skin, not by their character? What if I told you she was sexually abused 3 or 4 times by family members and friends before she was 13? What's the future for this child? And what if I told you at 13 she got pregnant exactly like her mother? The only difference was when the baby was born, it died. It was stillborn. Now, what would that do to a healthy adult to have a stillborn child, much less a 13-year-old child? She went a little crazy. They actually institutionalized her, but there weren't enough beds. So when a man came by and claimed to be her father, who she'd never met, Oprah Winfrey left with him. That's her story, most of you know, right? Now, this is Oprah. You must have a hand for Oprah, for God's sakes. Give her a hand. It's unbelievable, right? Because the thing that we all do is we all come up with a reason why our life is the way it is, and we tend to look backwards at something that happened to us. But we've all had happenings. Who's had horrible, shitty, terrible things happen in your life here? Raise your hand. Say, I. Who's done horrible, stupid things you hope no one will ever find out? Say, I. Okay? So it's not unique. No one's story is that unique. We all have a story of challenge. Some sound more challenging than others. And if you haven't had any challenges thus far in your life, problems are coming. Aren't you glad you showed up for this positive seminar? Right? But it's because what makes us grow? And so early on, I started trying to find these answers, and I began to realize, okay, I can take control of my life if I stop making the excuses and if I start realizing the only thing that matters is right now. That right now, the decisions you and I make right now are controlling our life. They're controlling what you think, they're controlling what you feel, they're controlling the result you're getting. And how long does it take to change your whole life? How long? How long? People say it takes 10 years to make a change, they'll tell me. It took me a decade to do this. And I say, bullshit, it did not take you a decade. It took you a moment. There's a moment when your brain said, no more. There's a moment when you said, I quit, let's begin. I love you, I do, it's over. How fast can our life change? How fast? Literally in a moment. And so when I started to get that, things change. But the only thing that gets in the way is many of you now understand this, but then you recruit humans. And some of these humans you recruit seem to die on the vine. Who's had this experience before? You know, they're really excited for a while, and then they try something that doesn't work, or someone whispers in the ear that this horrible network marketing thing, it's a pyramid scheme, or some story they tell them, or some comedian gets on television and does a tirade for 30 minutes, right? I can only imagine how pissed off you must have been if you were watching that. But here's the truth. If it was easy, everyone would do it. You don't want it to be easy. You just want to be better. You want to be stronger. You want to be more. And so part of the challenge for so many people is in the last 25 years, most of us who live in the Western part of the world, Western society at least, and I know you're from all over the world in this room, but especially those from North America, we've all been conditioned to start to believe that when things go wrong, it must be someone else's fault and we should sue them. Is it true? Right? People now, they spill their own coffee going to McDonald's, reaching for it, and they burn themselves and they sue McDonald's for $100 million for scarring them for life. This is the society we live in. And it started, and I don't know how many of you, because you're from all over the world, remember this, but I'm curious. How many of you remember years ago, a couple of brothers, twin brothers from LA called the Menendez brothers? Does anybody remember them? Raise your hand if you remember, I'm curious. Wow. About, what, 40, 50, 60, maybe 60% of you remember them. These two young kids in their early 20s, about to turn 30 if I remember correctly, they decide that their parents have all the money and they're not releasing it to them, so they take out shotguns and they kill their parents at point-blank range because they wanted the money. And when they go to jail and they put them in the jury trial, they say, yes, but they were abusive. Oprah was abused. She didn't kill anybody. If they were abusive, they should be punished, but that's what courts are for, right? They admitted they did it. They admitted they killed their parents in cold blood, and our society changed so much that the jurors said, yes, but if they were abused, maybe that wasn't, maybe they were forced to kill them. It took two jury trials to convince them. That's when this began to change. And right around the same time, there was a woman in New York City who got really upset with her husband. And so in the middle of the night, she took out a carving knife. Does anybody remember this story? What was her name? Bobbitt. Interesting last name, Bobbitt. Isn't that interesting? She takes out a carving knife and she chops off Mr. Happy. She takes Mr. Happy in a car and then she throws him in a field. And when they go to the jury trial, they go, is she guilty? Is she guilty? If Mr. Happy's not attached, she is guilty of sin. Gentlemen, if you agree, make some noise. Is she guilty? Now listen, he's an idiot. If he did stupid things, if he hurt her, he should go to jail. But again, that's what juries are for. This one woman is responsible for more men sleeping on their stomach after a fight than any woman in history. But you know what? I don't feel bad for him. He's kind of an idiot. You know who I feel bad for? The highway patrolman who had to go looking for this thing. What'd they do when they found it? You pick it up. No, you pick it up. I tell you this because our society has changed so much that when things don't go well, we look for someone to blame. And whether it's the President of the United States or the President-elect, whenever people are disappointed, they point the finger. And I know you're not that kind of person or you wouldn't be here, but I also know you and I recruit people from that circle. And how many of us have been guilty of blaming something outside ourselves? Raise your hand and say, I. So for me, what it became was an obsession to say, what are the things we can do to change our lives as quickly as humanly possible? And once I understood those things, I began to realize there are patterns. If you think that you're broken, there's nobody in this room that's broken. There's nobody that needs to be helped that way. What we do have is patterns. Some patterns make you happy. Some make you miserable. Some patterns get you to take action and just go crazy. And some patterns will make you plan for the rest of your freaking life. You've always got a plan, but you're never executing it. Who knows what I'm talking about here? Say I. And so what I became obsessed with is understanding what are the patterns that can change the quality of your life the fastest. And once I learned those, I started getting the phone calls from everybody. Then I started getting the phone call. I get the call when people are at their best and they're the best in the world, because the best in the world always knows one insight and I can take my whole life, change my whole life. How many distinctions, how many insights do you need to change your business tonight for the rest of your life? How many do you need? How many? One that you actually what? Actually apply, you actually implement, you actually make happen. And so for me, I became obsessed with that. So I start getting the phone calls. I get the phone call when the athlete's burning down on national television. It's Serena Williams. You know, she's just had a family member die and her whole world's melting down. I got to step in and do it right now, produce the result, and she wins. And because I've been able to do that for 39 years, I started when I was 2, in case you're curious. This is going to be my 40th year in 3 months, which blows my crazy mind. This is nuts, right? Totally nuts. But because I understand what to do to help create change there, because I've done it over and over again, I get those calls, or I get the phone call when the child is suicidal or the adult. And knock on wood, in 39 years, I've never lost one suicide out of thousands. In fact, we have films of them. I'm really, really grateful. I might someday, you know, knock on wood. But the reason is some of the things I'm going to share with you tonight, because I'm excited to share with you the insights that can show you how to change any emotion, any behavior in minutes. Because when you learn how to change what drives everything else, all your actions are driven by your thoughts, feelings, and emotions. You know that. But how do we change them when we don't feel like it? And how do we do it consistently so we produce a completely different life than most people? I get the phone call, true story, when the President of the United States calls me, true story, President Clinton, and says, they're going to impeach me in the morning. What should I do? I'm like 31 years old, the president's calling me, what should I do? You're going to impeach me in the morning? Could you call me sooner? That's my question, right? But I figured out what to do. And because I've had to figure out these situations over and over again, I've gotten insights. Plus, the other part is that I believe from my original teacher, Jim Rohn, that success leaves clues. Who's with me on this? Say I. That if someone is successful over and over again, they're not lucky. They're doing something different than everybody else. And instead of thinking how lucky they are, you and I got to figure out what they're doing to do the same thing. If we sow the same seeds, we'll reap the same rewards. So I've spent the last 39 years working with some of the greatest entrepreneurs in the world. I want to give you some insights this afternoon, this evening about people like Mark Benioff. If you know Salesforce.com, Mark came to my Unleash the Power Within seminar 3 times in a row. And then all of a sudden, he's about my size. He stands up in the front row. You can't miss him. He comes up to me and says, remember me. He said, I'm leaving Oracle today. I'm leaving my job, something all of us in this room had to do at one point or considered. And he said, I'm going to leave Oracle, take the big jump. I'm going to start this new company called Salesforce.com. And he said, Tony, you mark my words. We're going to change the business world. We're going to do $100 million in business. That was 15 years ago. I tease Mark now, because now he's doing $8 billion this year. And everybody from Facebook to Apple uses him as their back end to GE, right? But this man has strategies and insights that are valuable for you in your network marketing business. Or my dear friend Steve Wynn, I was just with him today, built half the city, total genius in what he does, creative, comes up with answers that no one would normally think of. Or somebody like John Paul DeJoria, who spent literally slept in his car, didn't even have a car, slept in the park initially, then in a car, and created Paul Mitchell Hair Care Systems, and then turned around and created one of the biggest tequila brands in the world in Patron. Multi-billionaire starting with nothing. I just spent 5 years interviewing 50 billionaires that are not from the lucky sperm club, meaning they didn't inherit it, they had to earn it. And I've learned the patterns that all of them share in common to make these things change. So I want to share those with you tonight, but there's one challenge. You're all wonderful. I know you guys are fully engaged. You traveled all this way. You're in this giant room all the way back. How many of you, though, have gone to an environment before where you learned something that was truly valuable, but and you were excited about it? No one was selling you. You were like, this would make a difference in my business. And then you went home, and you never applied what you learned in any real way. Who's ever done this before? Raise your hand. Scream the word, I. How many have done this more than once? Say, I. How many still feel intelligent? Say, I. You shouldn't. Now, I've done it too. So how can we be smart human beings? How can we be smart individuals and still be in a place where we learn something, we spend money, we travel across the country, and then not apply it? The reason is because everyone in this room, or I shouldn't say not everyone, most of you in this room, as I look around, went to a 20th century school, didn't you? How many went to a 20th century school? I'm curious. Yes. If you went to a 20th century school, it was designed to make you comply. It was designed to make you step and be a certain way. The bell rang when you were a child, and what you learned from the earliest stages, even in kindergarten, what are you supposed to do when that bell rings? What are you supposed to do? Report to your position. Sit down at your desk. And are you supposed to then initiate, make things happen, start conversations? What were you taught? When the bell rings, what do? Sit down and what? Shut up. Now today, and don't do anything until you're told what to do. Today, if you're in business and you sit down and shut up and you don't talk to your neighbor, you're out of business. Who's with me here? Say I. So there's a problem. The problem is all of you in this room have conditioning of at least 12 to 16 years that learning is sitting passively while someone else talks at you. And there's nothing wrong with that, except when you sit passively, even if you're enjoying yourself going, wow, that man has huge freaking teeth. Or, wow, what he's saying is really valuable. Whatever you're thinking in your head, if even if you're having a good time, but you're sitting passively, then when you learn something, it gets linked to the state you learn it in. So even if you're enjoying yourself, this is really good. That's good stuff. I'm going to change my life. Yeah. And then later on, you go to do it, you go, oh, I'm kind of tired, right? Because the state you learn in is different. So what I'd like to do before we do anything else, so you really retain and make use of this, is let's really change our state even more. Let's get ourselves active. And the way we're going to get active is use our body. So stand up, if you would, just for a moment. Shake your body out. Shake your body out. Shake it out, shake it out, shake it out. Jump up and down a little bit like a little kid, shaking your body out, waking it up, waking it up. And then here's what we want to do before we do anything else. I want you, how many of you would agree that if you're going to influence someone, a big part of what influences them is not just what you say, but the energy you have? How many would agree with this? Say I. In fact, what is charisma? When you say somebody has charisma, what the hell is charisma? How many would agree it's an energy that people have? Say I. And we all have energy, but the problem is, when you're trying to build a business and you bump into obstacles or challenges, or even if you're on a roll and something interrupts it, it's so easy to get overwhelmed or frustrated or stressed or just lose a little bit of your edge. What I found is the higher your energy, the greater the execution. The lower the energy, the more you know stuff and don't follow through. I'm here to tell you, tonight is not just about knowledge, because, you know, knowledge is interesting. Knowledge is not power. Knowledge is potential power. You know, execution trumps knowledge every day of the week. So in order to get you to execute, we got to simplify things. Complexity is the enemy of execution. The more complex you make something, the harder it is to duplicate in your business, isn't it? The harder it is to use. So I'm going to oversimplify it so that we actually do it. And the first thing I want you to start with is, if you don't listen to anything else I say, the number one key to success in life is increasing your energy and sustaining that energy. Because at a high level of energy, you come up with different solutions. Who's ever snapped at somebody or gotten mad and had nothing to do with them? It was just you were in a shitty state. Who knows what I'm talking about here? Say I. Whoever has snapped at someone else, who's ever done the snapping here? Okay, a few honest people. So here's what I want you to do. Shake your body out. Before we do anything else, I just want you to turn the person near you, point them and go, I own you. No, say it like you mean it. I own you. No, I own you. Now, when you say I own you, what you're really saying is I challenge you, you old person, to a higher level of energy. And I'm going to outdo your energy. So when I say now, we're going to clap together slowly. At the peak of it, we're going to go one, two, three. And then your job is to celebrate, scream, yell, dance, like you just achieved the ultimate goal and you're a little kid, not a boring-ass adult that goes, yay. Your goal is to outdo the energy of your partner by being more crazy than they are. So face the partner and say, I own you. No, I own you. No, I own you. All right, let's clap together. Ready? One. On three. One. Two. Three, go crazy! Say you rock, baby, and grab a seat. Grab a seat in a peak state. Now, I want you to see how long that lasted. Yay! Ah, shit, I'm back in my chair. See, watch and see if your partner did this, if afterwards they went, yay, and they went, oh, jeez. Oh. Gotta get my chair now so I can sit down because this freaking crazy Robbins guy's got us jumping and stuff. So right now in your chair, create as much energy in your chair as you had when you were standing. Sit down in a peak state. Sit down in a peak state. When you sit down, don't let the energy disappear. Keep that energy in the chair. Come on. Come on now. Stay in your chair. Make the sound. Don't let the energy disappear. People go get pumped up and it lasts like 5 minutes and then they go back into their hole. See if you can keep that energy even there. Look at the person either side of him. Show them what you look like in a peak state in your chair. Show them what you look like. Question for you. In an energized state, are you likely to sit back or take action? Which one? When two people meet, if there's rapport, if there's respect, if there's a connection, you can't just be a crazy person. The person with the most energy, the person with the most passion, the person with the most conviction will eventually influence the other person if there is respect established, if there is rapport established. But what happens is you get sold on what they can do instead of persuading them what they can do. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't think you should pick everybody. I think the biggest mistake you have is recruiting everyone. I think you should be much more selective. I think if you were to change what's going on in you, you'd find no difficulty recruiting. Because it's really hard to really feel recruited by somebody when they're like, come here, I love you, I want you. It's a little overwhelming, isn't it? Your heart just stopped, I saw it. And so some of you are so enthusiastic, you're like, heal, you're coming with me. But perhaps there's a better way. So I want to start with a subject no one likes. Tell me, who here has ever failed miserably at something you really wanted to achieve? Who here has failed miserably? Raise your hand, say I. If you don't raise your hand, you lie about other shit too, don't you? So when you fail to achieve what you want, tell me why you failed. Raise your hand. Anyone at all. You, ma'am, thanks for raising your hand. What is it you failed at? And why did you fail? Give her a hand, ladies and gentlemen. What's your name? Where are you from?
From Minneapolis.
Emily from Minneapolis, ladies and gentlemen. You didn't hear me. I said it's Emily from Minneapolis, ladies and gentlemen. Emily, what did you fail at and why?
Pursuing a relationship with my dad.
Pursuing a relationship with your dad. And you failed to connect with him at the level you wanted? Or?
Yeah, connect.
Is he still alive?
He is, yeah.
Well, then you can still succeed.
Why
did you fail so miserably in connecting with him?
Because I got let down.
You got let down.
A lot.
Now, what the hell does that mean, I got let down? Does that mean you had expectations that weren't met?
Yes.
Yes.
Exactly.
Now, what are the chances in your life that your expectations are going to be met by your father, your mother, your brother, your sister, all of your downline, all of your upline, the federal government? What are the chances that your expectations are going to be met the majority of the time? What are the chances? Where would you put it on a 0-10 scale where 10 is absolutely certain and 0 is probably not very often or never? Where would you put it?
Zero.
And yet, we have these predictable problems in our life, and you're going to discover today they come from expectation. And if you and I could trade expectation for appreciation, she would have a different relationship with her father. She has all her expectations, which aren't being met, and then she feels hurt because it's all about her. I'm not making this negative towards you in any way. I hope you know where I'm coming from. I just know because I've done this myself. That's why I know. And unless we can be honest with ourselves, we won't be successful. If you're building a business or you're building a relationship, of course you have goals and desires, but your expectations are what are making you crazy. Because I can tell you, when I started my career, I had giant expectations. And guess what I discovered? Most people overestimate what they're going to do in a year, massively. And they underestimate what they can do in a decade or two or three or four. And it's just amazing what can happen when you expand to appreciation and when you stop expecting from others. I always tell people you get what you tolerate, but it's what you tolerate in yourself. So tell me, what was your expectation for your father that wasn't met and why did you fail? This is deep shit. We were supposed to be talking about business and stuff. We're already into our relationship. What the hell?
I just wanted him to be around, come to my games, be there for me, cheer me on.
But he didn't.
No.
Why?
I'm not sure.
Well, you've come up with a story about it, and the story gives you pain.
It does.
Yeah, so what's the story you've told yourself? I want you to remember this, because later on tonight, we'll turn this for you. It's so much easier to see in someone else, right? And by the way, look what we're doing. We're going straight for failure. Isn't this feel good? The very subject you want to talk about, right? But unless we can deal with failure, you'll never have success at the level you deserve. Who's with me on this? Say I. So let's get honest with ourselves. So the story you had was, I see that little tear.
I had a brother pass away before I was born. And so when I was born, I was a girl.
Yes, I see that.
Yes. And he left the hospital because he was upset. And that story was told to me growing up.
And you've told that story to yourself continuously since then, right?
Yes, I guess I have.
So can I ask you a question? Is it possible your father totally loves you?
Yes.
Is it more than possible? Is it probable?
Yes.
Is it true that he loves you?
Yes.
Then I just want you to know, this is what we do to ourselves. We fail because we come up with a story that actually meets some of our needs. The need to feel important, the need to feel significant, the need to feel like I have this pain, I want you to share it with me. And so many of us make up a story, and the story just isn't true, but we live the story. I don't know your father, so I can't say for sure, but I'd be willing to bet money that your father loves you and adores you. He just doesn't do it the way you think he should.
Right.
Right? You want him to do these things, go those games, all those pieces. Was your father hard on you?
He just wasn't around.
Just wasn't around. And what was he doing when he wasn't around?
Working.
That bastard.
I know.
He was working? What's wrong with him?
I'm proud of him for that, but...
Yes. Is it possible that for him, working was the only way he could feel he had enough worth within himself?
Yes.
To be worthwhile?
Yes.
And that he was busy trying to keep himself together because he didn't think he was enough?
Yes.
So it really had nothing to do with you. So why did you fail to reach him?
Well, I just got mad. I'm like, I'm sick of being rejected. I'm sick of you saying...
Did he reject you, or did he just not do what you wanted him to do the way you wanted it?
That's right, yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
By the way, that's what most of you call rejection. It's rejection when people don't do what you want them to do. But most people are not going to do what you want them to do. What successful people do is they just know that rejection means you still need more experiences. I'm going to provide them. I'm going to provide the right kind of experience until you can get to the yes. So what prevented you from reaching your father?
I just thought, I don't need you anymore. You've hurt me enough, so I'm going to push you away.
So the truth is, your father didn't reject you. You rejected your father.
I guess, through the years, yeah.
Took you years, but you did it successfully.
I did.
So you successfully pushed him away.
I did.
Yes. And so the real reason you didn't reach him was because you were inside yourself. You weren't in connection with him. It's hard to connect with other people when you're inside yourself. It's the hardest part is to recruit somebody when you're inside your head thinking, am I coming across right? What am I going to say? What am I going to do? People ask me all the time, how the hell do you get up and do 50, 60, 70 hours in a weekend or a week? You don't have any notes and you don't seem to miss a beat. What is it? Because I came out here with a plan and it's already gone. What matters is I step in the audience, I see and feel what's happening right here, right now, and I respond to what's happening right here, right now that's real. And realness is so unique, even reality television is bullshit, so it's like it's so rare when you see something real and rare. And that's all any of us need. People are starving for real. But it's hard to be real when you're focused on yourself. People are afraid of public speaking because they're getting up thinking how they're doing. I'm not thinking how I'm doing. I know I'm not doing good at times, but I don't care. What I care is, do I serve you? Do I get you to the outcome? And I will get you there. If you stay with me today, we will get there. There's zero question. Because that's the way that I function, right? It's the way it works, right? You too, right? Who's with me on this? Say, ah! So it's not settling. So the real truth of the matter is, you failed because why? You failed to reach him really because...
it was about me.
Because it was about me. And it's really hard to connect with someone when you're focused on yourself. And I get it because you felt that sense of loss. But tonight, I have two outcomes. I want the business outcomes I want to deliver for you to show you what to do to go to the next level. Who came here for that, by the way? I'm curious. Say I. And then I have my mission of what I want to make sure you leave with, which is even more important than the business, but I want to deliver on the business outcome first. But the second outcome is even more important, and I never expected to start out with this. I was looking for something different, but I appreciate it. What would happen if you went back to your father and just said, I just want to apologize to you, Dad. I've been so self-obsessed with what I thought you should do for me that I just missed all the love you were giving to me.
That would feel good. I'm doing it.
Good.
Yes.
And how would he respond to that?
I hope good. Yes.
What's that?
I hope you respond well.
Yes, even if he doesn't respond well on the outside, some people don't know how to deal with that kind of communication.
Right.
But if you become more attuned to what's really going on, everything will change. I want you all to try something for a moment, just for a moment. I want you just for a second, look around this room and notice four things you didn't notice even though you've been here for a day. Look around this room and notice four things you didn't notice. Four things, bless you, that you didn't notice. What are four things you didn't notice that are near? Raise your hand if you can find four. I'm curious if you've been able to find four. Raise your hand. Okay. Some of you are a little quicker than others. Some are in the slow learning group, I can see. Okay. Now try this. Try this just for a moment. Pull out your right index finger. Where was it? Look at your finger and notice five things about your right index finger you've never noticed before. Notice five things you've never noticed before about your index finger. Can you find them? Raise your hand if you can find five. Let me see if you found five. Good. Show the person next to you. Show them the five things that are so special that you've never noticed before. Go ahead. Show it to them. Okay, stop. Now try this. Now try this. Turn the person next to you and don't speak. Just look at them and notice five things about them you've not noticed up until now. Don't speak. Just notice five things about them you've not noticed. Even though you've been sitting next to them for some time. And notice how they feel when you're noticing them. Notice how you feel when they're noticing you. How many found five things about either what they're feeling or that you're noticing? Raise your hand if you found five things. Good. Tell them what the four or five things are you noticed real quick. Just tell them. All right, time. I know you weren't able to share everything in such a short period of time. How many of you noticed five things about the person who's sitting next to you that you've not noticed up until now? Raise your hand if you were able to do it. Raise your hand nice and high so I can see. Say, ah. How many at least got four? Raise your hand, at least four. Great. Now, by the way, how many of you are sitting next to someone you've known for years? I'm just curious. And you're just now noticing this shit. What is going on here? Someone raise your hand, give me an example of what you noticed with someone you actually know. Raise your hand, somebody. Yes, ma'am, right there. Give her a hand. Someone had to do it. Give her a hand. Come on, man. Back for you one day. We'll be coming back. What's your name? Where are you from?
I'm Sandra. From California.
From where?
Hold on. I'm Sandra from California.
From California, ladies and gentlemen. Come on, look at that. We'll be coming back for you one day. So, do you know this woman?
Absolutely, I know her.
Great. How long have you known her for?
I've known her for 9 years.
Okay. And what did you notice about her that you didn't notice for 9 years?
I had no idea she wore those kinds of shoes.
That's the important shit, gentlemen, the shoes. Okay?
It's silly, but...
And what did you notice about these shoes?
They're boots. Work boots?
Like work boots?
Yeah.
You seem troubled by these boots. Okay, what else did you notice besides her work boots?
Well, I noticed that the hem here... There's like a double stitch.
A double stitch on the pant.
And I knew she was wearing a turtleneck, but I didn't realize that it wasn't a cut, like a turtleneck that was tight to her neck. It's more loose fitting.
Yes.
And her jacket, I didn't notice that she had brought that jacket.
Yes. Did you notice what she was feeling at all when you were noticing her?
Oh, she's so beautiful.
Yes. But what was she feeling? You were feeling she was beautiful. This is going somewhere. I'm not quite sure where, but it's going somewhere.